If you say what you wanna say. Everyone, and thank you so much for joining me here tonight for the second edition of Reboot Festival. My name is Ioana, and I will be the one starting week one of this wonderful festival with my show Growing Into My Skin. For the next 20 minutes, you will be hearing some of my poems. I kind of look at this show as my origin story. All the chapters that have led me to where I am today, that have made me the person I am today. We are all stories still being written. And as different as we might be from one another, you might find that some of the chapters are the same. I hope you find yourselves in at least some of the chapters in my story. So let's start. Chapter 1, Womanhood. I was born a woman. I didn't really have much say in the matter, but a lot of my experience has been shaped by my gender. So that's why my story begins with womanhood. I'm a woman, hear me roar. But I don't want to roar. It seems as if women all we ever do is roar, and I'm tired. I want to purr. I want to not have my back arched ready to attack in self-defense. I don't want my sister, my mother, my friends to be proud of me for sticking up for myself. I don't want to have to stick up for myself. I don't want to roar anymore just to try and break the feeling of screaming underwater. I don't want to be strong anymore. I want to be soft. I don't want to explain that feminism isn't the enemy anymore, and while male's aggressiveness or anger makes me feel scared even if he's a friend. Maybe more so if he's a friend, because he's meant to make me feel safe. Even if my mind knows that he would never hurt me, my body doesn't. I'm tired of carrying myself tall, puffing myself up so to hide my vulnerability so that it won't get taken advantage of. I don't want to roar anymore. I don't want to have tough conversations anymore. I'm tired of pretending that women have the answer to stopping the ills done to us. We don't. They don't start from us, so how in the world are we expected to be able to stop them? I don't want to roar anymore because no one is listening anyways, except for us, women, to one another, and I can't bear to hear another story. I don't want to roar anymore because a roar that encounters a deaf ear sounds like nothing more than silence. There you go, a gift for you. Keep it this. If you don't like it, you can burn it or something. It's kind of difficult to destroy because it's laminated. Tell her she's smart. Tell her she's brave. Tell her she's funny. Tell her you never knew if you were doing life right before you met her, but she chose to be with you, so you must have done at least something right. Tell her she gives you a boner just by walking into the room. It's irrelevant if you're a man or a woman, the point still stands. Tell her you know she can be anything she wants to, and you're grateful right now she wants to be with you. Tell her your secrets, hopes, dreams, and disappointments. Tell her you know she's a one-woman army, but when she's tired, she doesn't have to be. Tell her she's a goddess, a queen, an Amazon, a unicorn, or whatever other shape she desires. Tell her the sun rises between her thighs and sets somewhere along her collarbone. Look at her as if she put the stars in the sky, as undeniable proof of existence of a higher power, because she is it. Be her biggest fan and her partner in crime. Be her partner with equal rights. Tell her all the corny, silly, embarrassing things your manliness would never allow you to even imagine saying. And when the time comes, tell her you love her. Not because she needs to hear it, but because she deserves to. I'm not saying lie to her. I'm saying, if you don't feel all those things, why even bother? She's a temple, she's a marble column, a stained glass window, the whole Sistine Chapel, the seven wonders of the modern world. So don't you dare tarnish her by seeing her as anything less. Here we are, a gift for you. If you're not a woman, I'm not sure you understand. But try to make the picture fit in your head. Here is me coming home from a party, work, or going to the airport in the middle of the night. Walking down the street while always looking behind, praying to all saints known to humankind who are clutching my keys a little too tight. Here is me and my friends, putting on a brave front while dancing in a club, trying to fend off guys that after being rejected curse at us and call us snobs.
Shame is what I feel when I finally get home and I realize I'm not strong enough to be safe on my own. I only feel at ease when my back against my apartment's door, breathing in and out, trying to calm down while lying on the floor. It's an achievement. Another night gone when I made it safely home. I really don't get why it's so difficult for men to understand that no means no. It's not a decision I have to defend. Buying me a drink doesn't buy my time. Take your hands off. I'll just stand here, nod and smile while pretending that everything is fine. No, I'm not always happy, nor should I be. I'm not a plastic doll in a shop's window grinning mindlessly so it gives you pleasure to check me out from head to toe sleazily. I'm not your bad girl, nor am I good. I'm a human being. I don't belong to you, in case you misunderstood. I'm just so damn tired of having to pretend that I have a boyfriend in order to make a douche's tiny brain comprehend that when I say no, it's not something he can bend. If you are my boyfriend, then you should get into your head that's not a free pass or some kind of commitment to always please you. Nor should I lie on my back just to pay for the attention or affection that you choose to give me. If you actually care about me, I won't have to explain that I'm sometimes too tired of sharing my thoughts, my time, and my bed, and I'd much rather go home to watch Netflix and chill alone in my sweatpants instead. I don't give a fuck if it's construed as rude, but on some days I'm just not in the mood. So the point I'm trying to make is that there's no excuse for harassment or abuse, be it that you are or not my boyfriend, husband, or a random guy on the tube. I'm not a freaking object of which you can just make use with no regards to whether it is my ego or something more gets bruised. I have the right to always feel safe in my skin, whether I'm dancing, walking, or simply existing. I shouldn't have to ask anyone to allow me to be in charge of my own body. Chapter 2. Love. I wish this was wine. Why does it come after womanhood? Because I think the way in which I love has been shaped by my gender. As women, we're taught to be soft, to give, to be caring, but no one really teaches us how to receive. I had my first love at the age of 4, and then a bunch of puppy loves after. So by 18, I was sure that I knew perfectly what love was. But then I fell truly, madly in love for the first time. And boy, oh boy, did that change me. I hope your brand new leather jacket catches fire from one of your cigarettes, you lame brown-eyed James Dean wannabe. I hope you trip and break your neck while wearing your black Converses. I hope you drown while trying to chug a pint of beer. Or your chic necklace suddenly becomes tight and strangles you. Even choking on some mushrooms would do. I hope your favorite CD explodes while you're listening to it in your room. I hope you get paper cuts from the book you're currently reading after inexplicably developing hemophilia and you bleed out a miserable prick. I hope all your Tinder dates finally meet each other and murder you out of revenge. I could even accept you dying while having sex with someone else. I hope you laugh so hard that you literally can't breathe anymore. Because you taught me that things you love can kill you. Not all at once, or suddenly, but surely and daily, mostly to their absence. FYI, I don't hope you die in your sleep. That would be too easy. I don't know, because you've all loved it. You're gonna have to check in on it and then copy it. I love you like I love coming home at the end of a long day. I love you like the sun shining through my bedroom window without getting mad when clouds are blocking its way. I love you like a tight hug when I'm falling apart or my warm scarf in winter. I love you like the smell of clean clothes or the taste of cinnamon. I love you like a cup of tea on a Sunday morning. I love you like sleeping in. I could have just started with that and the rest of this poem would have become redundant. I love you without reason or hope, because hope often exceeds people's expectations. I love you through all the mess we've made of things, the ugliness, the fighting. I love you because we've braved the storm and we're now here enjoying the quiet. I'm so glad we're done with the hatred. I love you like the best and worst parts of me, like my family and my best friend. I love you like the first person who ever truly saw me. I love you while knowing we won't get the classic happy ending. But isn't a love like this a happy ending in itself? I love you from afar because spending too much time with you would make me doubt the previous statement. I love you when you're happy with someone else and you write her poems instead. And I'll still love you through my bittersweet tears on your wedding day. I love you through all the boys I've dated since and all I'll fall in love with because my love for you doesn't take up space. It's just like breathing. I love you because we'll never share this bond with anyone else. It will be the best kept secret, and that's enough. I love you, it seems, from the beginning of time and probably much after the end of it. I love you like people are meant to be loved, wholeheartedly and unconditionally. Date night. Tonight, I'm going on a date, and I wish I could tell you about it. I know that might be twisted, but it's you, and you should know everything about me. Tonight, I'm going on a date, so I put on a nice dress and my favorite perfume, and I know he'll like it. And I'm mad at you for forcing me to learn all these new faces and names, favorite colors and family trees. He looks at me with eyes that are blue or green, or who knows, it doesn't matter because they are not yours. Eyes that made me look like everything I wanted before I met you. Tonight I'm going on a date and it hasn't even started, but I'm already tired of the mere idea of making an effort. I'll meet him and God knows I'll try my best not to compare, and while I'm having some random conversation with him in an unfamiliar place, I'll pretend that I forgot how you made me laugh and that any space you're in suddenly became my home. Tonight I'm going on a date as if it is a choice I made, not the only one I was given. As if I wouldn't give up all these dates and promises of fancy dinners for Sunday nights dancing and cooking dinner with you in a one-bedroom flat somewhere. One of these dates will lead to a second one and a third and many more after that. Then further down the line to two little girls who will look just like me and not resemble you at all. And I'll call that the way it was meant to be. I just hope by the time I do, I will actually believe it. Chapter 3. Mental health. Yeah. That's such a buzzword, isn't it? I mean, we all know what it means, to some extent at least. We all talk about it, advocate for it, but there's still so much stigma around it. I was 13 when I was first prescribed antidepressants. 18 when I started going to therapy. 20 when I believed for the first time that maybe my whole existence won't have to be overshadowed by my many mental health issues. I was right. I wish technical supports for brain existed, but how would that work? Have you tried turning it on and off again? Yes, that's the problem. It never turns off. It's just on and on and on, and sometimes 1,000 programs are running at the same time and the system crashes. A regular sleep restart won't do the trick because it's blocked beyond the point of restarting, and I get scared that it somehow got infected with malware despite my CBT antivirus. I really can't afford to reinstall the system and lose all the data I have saved on the drive. All my photos, poems, passwords. Sometimes I can't even watch a whole film without it overheating. So I write a couple lines of poetry instead of code, as I don't have to worry about the semicolon fucking everything up, and I was never that good at coding to begin with. I think I need to debug it. But how do I do that without unplugging it? I'm running low on memory storage space. Maybe some headspace will help. 10 minutes a day of being guided by an unknown friend. I write and I write and I write until lines mingle into one another only vaguely makes sense. Words become ones and zeros, taking it back to basics. If the system is working again, and some sort of order has been restored, then one. If not, zero. If value equals zero, repeat program until value equals one. minutes does it take to fill the void?
I couldn't tell you.
I haven't reached that number yet. At the moment, it's 8 and still counting.
How many chocolates does it take to make it warm outside?
I'm afraid that's not a chocolate thing, but you could turn on your heater. It would help if heating wasn't so damn expensive.
How many chocolates does it take to feel like you're in love? Serotonin and all that.
I think more than it takes to give you diabetes.
You are valuable. You are smart. You are beautiful. I wrote on a post-it note stuck to my bathroom mirror, so that every morning when I get up and look at myself, I have an alternative to the creeping self-doubt. And when my eyes see my face in the mirror, my brain will make a correlation between my being and the messages, and I'll trick it into believing them. Say it 3 times without rolling your eyes. Say it until your damage no longer has the shape of monsters under your bed and skeletons in your closet, but resembles an unknowing acquaintance from a distant past that's not important enough to have a major impact over you. Say it until you matter enough to yourself that you won't base yourself world solely on your achievements. Say it until you no longer crave validation. Say it until "you're not good enough" stops being yelled constantly in the back of your head, but it becomes a whisper. Say it until you can enjoy the ride, but also until you reach your happy ending. We are what happens to us. I'm the sum of the scars left by experiences past. I'm my parents' constant fighting, my mother's codependence and excess of love, and my father's lack thereof. I'm my grandfather's and best friend's debts and the goodbyes I didn't get the chance to say. I'm all the time I wasted thinking I have more of it. I'm my desperate desire to raise children that won't have to recover from it, and my fear of abandonment. Because no matter how much I try, I can never make anything last, and everyone goes away sooner or later. I am my many mental health issues, the result of living in society. The spit and the rugs that at some point grazed my skin. And all those times I thought I had finally had enough, thinking I couldn't keep going because the going had gotten too tough. I am my uprootedness and my torturing jealousy that sometimes gets the best of me. I'm all the insults thrown my way, particularly the ones I say to myself. Because if someone tells you something long enough, you start to believe it. I'm all the boys I called that never called back. By this point, I've even stopped keeping track. I'm all the people I've loved more than they could ever love me. I'm that one guy that most of my poems are about, to whom I gave the best of me, and he decided it wasn't enough. I'm my imposter syndrome and my crippling self-doubt. I'm the weirdly sickly person I've been my whole life. I'm all the people who mistreated. I'm whatever the universe, life, God, or whoever knows what chose that should happen to me. I'm sometimes lost, lonely, sad, and angry when the walls of the life I built start to crumble. I'm wounded, stitched up, and bruised. But I'm also still kicking and breathing, giving, dancing, singing, loving, and most importantly, living. We are what happens to us. And it's maddening that it's not our fault, but we're still the ones fighting with ourselves to repair the damage. But there's no point in wallowing in it. Regarding ourselves as victims won't solve anything. We are what happens to us. But it's in our power to use the horrible things we've been through to help ourselves grow. Let's use it as ammo. We are all works of art, glorious, unique, and bright. The centerpieces of life's weird, beautiful, painful show. We are what happens to us. But much more than that, we are what we choose to make of.
Okay, all the way to the back now. Thank you.
Final chapter. Life. That's such a broad word. It's all-encompassing, and it can mean different things to different people. To some, it's just a really fun journey. And to others, it needs to have a higher purpose. I think, to me, it's just this gift that we never asked for, but we need to continuously pay for. It's glorious and bright and sometimes really hard, which just worth going through. If you get thrown into the deep end enough times, all that erratic kicking and pushing the water is bound to morph into something resembling swimming. And after a while, you realize that instead of drowning, you're managing to keep yourself afloat. What is heaven? To be this young, to be this sappy, to have this body and mind of mine, to have this scary and blissful uncertainty that comes with having the rest of my life ahead of me, to have the certainty the best days are yet to come, to enjoy life as it happens, not in hindsight, to have finally started to love myself, to be so fully aware of all of the above. Some days, my spirit feels so big that it can't be contained by my body, and I crawl out of my skin. The essence is too big for the shape, and if I stretch far enough, I can actually touch the sky. I fill myself with clouds, and I live off ideals, and if I am to fall, then so be it. I'd rather die from the fall than live a life crawling. So come and tell me how I'm not good enough, how I won't get anywhere, and all the things I've been through were in vain. Tell me how all my hopes and dreams will crumble and turn into disappointment and pain, so that I can laugh in your face. I'm used to growing in adversity. A plant from the desert has nothing on me. People keep romanticizing their teenage years, but I'm only now becoming who I was always meant to be. I look in the mirror, and I no longer see an enemy. I don't love myself as much as I want to, but at least I'm not mistaking self-deprecation for modesty. So I write this as an ode to all my many flaws. They are what they are, and they are a part of me. As long as I don't use them as an excuse to treat others ghastly, I choose to embrace them unapologetically. I'm growing up and into my own skin.